In this video, we want to continue our discussion of electron affinities by looking at some exceptions to the electron affinity periodic trends. Now, electron affinity is defined as the energy that is released when a neutral gaseous atom gains an electron in order to form an anion. And there are some important periodic trends related to electron affinity. For example, electron affinities tend to increase from left to right across a period. They tend to decrease as we move down a group. And they decrease when you go from a halogen in a period to the noble gas in that same period. However, there are some deviations and exceptions to these periodic trends, and that's what we want to discuss and explain in this particular video. So here's a table which shows the electron affinities for most of the atoms on our periodic table. Now, one thing I want to point out here is that these values tend to be negative. The negative sign does not mean that the energies are less than zero. The negative sign indicates that energy is released when the electron is added. A positive value means energy is absorbed in the process. A negative sign indicates energy is released. So, for example, for lithium, 59.6 kilojoules of energy is released when lithium accepts an electron. And if you look at these values, they tend to increase from left to right across a period. And that indicates, as these values get more and more negative, that means that it gets more likely or easier for the atom to accept an electron. So, for example, fluorine releases more energy when it accepts an electron than lithium, indicating that fluorine will accept an electron much more readily than lithium. But overall, the electron affinities tend to increase across a period. However, you see that there are some exceptions to this. Right off the bat, from lithium to beryllium, there's actually a drop in the electron affinity. So between group 1 and 2, and we also see that trend between group 1 and 2 in the third period, the fourth period, etc., etc. And as we move on over, we see that there's a drop in the electron affinity between carbon and nitrogen, indicating that nitrogen is less likely to accept an electron when compared to carbon. Same thing from silicon to phosphorus, germanium to arsenic, etc., etc. So we want to be able to explain this. But first, let me just show you the same data in a graphical form, because you may see it drawn like this, so I want to be sure we're clear. So you might want to pause the video and take a moment just to kind of look at this. So again, these are the electron affinities for elements on our periodic table, and here we have lithium, so this is the first atom in the second period, and here we have fluorine, which is group 7 in the second period, and overall the electron affinities tend to increase, meaning more energy is released, meaning the atom's more likely to accept an electron. However, from lithium to beryllium, there's a drop in the electron affinity, and then it goes up to carbon, and then it drops between carbon and nitrogen, as we saw before, and then it continues on up to fluorine. And then normally it drops between fluorine and neon, which is what we would expect. And then when we start the third period, from sodium to magnesium, there's a drop, it increases, and then between silicon and phosphorus, it drops and continues on. And this tends to play out throughout the periodic table. So why is this? Why does the electron affinity decrease between lithium and beryllium in period 2, sodium and magnesium in period 2, in period 3? And why does the electron affinity decrease between carbon and nitrogen in period 2 and silicon and phosphorus in period 3? So let's try to explain this, and let's look at lithium and beryllium and carbon and nitrogen. However, the same explanation that we're about to show, we could apply to any of these other periods to explain the trends. So here, let's start off by looking at lithium and beryllium. Now, the electron affinity, of course, we're adding an electron. So we have to look here at where the electron would go. Now here, we've added an electron, so we no longer have lithium. We have the lithium anion, and that electron would go into the 2s. For beryllium, we now have the beryllium anion, and the electron added to beryllium would go into a new subshell, the 2p. Now, the electron affinity, as we see down here at the chart, drops from lithium to beryllium, indicating that it is easier or more likely to add the electron to lithium than it is to add this electron to beryllium. So that's very important to appreciate. So why is that? Why is it easier to add the electron to lithium, or more energy is released, than when we add an electron to beryllium? Well, it depends, of course, on where the electron is going. Adding the electron to lithium, as we saw before, the electron goes into the 2s subshell. Whereas when we add it to beryllium, we're starting a brand new 2p subshell. Well, a 2s subshell is lower energy. It's spherical, it's closer to the nucleus, so the electrons in 2s subshells have a greater probability of being found closer to the nucleus. Whereas an electron in a 2p subshell, those electrons have a greater probability of being found further from the nucleus. So this would be somewhat of a higher energy subshell. So when we add the electron to the 2s subshell, it's a lower energy subshell than the 2p. And also, adding this electron to the 2s, it's not going to be heavily shielded by the other 2s electron. Because remember, electrons in the same subshell provide very little shielding. So therefore, this electron would be closer to the nucleus in lithium, and it would not experience a greater amount of shielding. So therefore, this 2s electron added to lithium would have a relatively higher effective nuclear charge than compared to beryllium. We'll explain that in a minute. So therefore, this electron, we would say, maybe is more likely to stick to lithium. So why is that? Why does this electron experience a higher effective nuclear charge than this one? Well, the electron added to lithium, we said already, goes into a 2p subshell. This is a higher energy subshell because this electron is going to be a little bit further from the nucleus because of the shape of 2p orbitals. And it would also, very importantly, this electron starting a new subshell, this electron is going to experience a relatively higher amount of shielding compared to this electron in lithium. Because now we've got, we're starting a new subshell, and so it's going to be more heavily shielded by these 2s electrons because they're not in the same subshell. So this electron is a little bit further from the nucleus, that's one. And second, it's going to experience more shielding compared to this electron, which is a little bit closer to the nucleus and will experience less shielding. So therefore, the electron added to beryllium would have a relatively lower effective nuclear charge and therefore would be held less tightly and less energy would be released compared to the electron added to lithium. So now, let's take a look at the periodic trend in electron affinities between carbon and nitrogen. So here's the arrow notation for carbon and nitrogen. Now again, let's add that electron and see where it goes. So now we no longer have carbon. We have the carbide anion and we have the nitride anion. We see here's the added electron to carbon. And where does the electron go for nitrogen? It's going to go to an already occupied p orbital. Now, again, when we go from carbon to nitrogen, there is a drop in the electron affinity, indicating that this electron in carbon is going to release more energy and is going to be added more easily than the electron that's added to nitrogen. So it's easier to add an electron to carbon than it is to nitrogen. Why is that? Well, adding the electron to carbon, the electron goes into an empty 2p orbital. So it's further away from these other electrons, and it's really not going to experience any additional repulsive force from these electrons compared to that of nitrogen. When we add the electron to nitrogen, it goes into an already half-filled, an already occupied 2p orbital. So these two electrons here are going to repel each other. So there's going to be an additional repulsive force that's not experienced by the electron added to carbon. So this electron added to nitrogen is not going to be held as tightly, and is going to be less likely to add to nitrogen than it would be to carbon because of this repulsive force between these electrons. So it's very important that you understand the electron affinity trends, the exceptions to these trends, and you can clearly explain why these exceptions are what they are. So be sure you take some time and practice that.